Good evening, and welcome to the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum. My name is Elaine Papoulias, and I am the director of the Kennedy School's COCALIS program on Southeast and East Central Europe, one of the sponsors of tonight's forum event, and I am honored to open today's proceedings. Ladies and gentlemen, while Shirin Ebadi's work has been focused in a region geographically disconnected from that of the COCALIS program, the causes that she champions and the complex ideological and public policy issues which she strives to elucidate transcend boundaries. And in fact, they could not be more relevant for the countries of Southeast Europe, burgeoning democracies which strive to deepen the roots of tolerance, dialogue, and respect for human rights. Shirin Ebadi is an individual whose work exalts peace, pluralism, and respect for diversity, and therefore has great meaning and resonance in every corner of the globe. It is extremely appropriate, therefore, that Shirin Ebadi speaks at the Kennedy School, an institution named in memory of President John F. Kennedy, one of our country's greatest advocates of the inviolability of the basic rights and freedoms of all peoples, and who, in a commencement address in 1963, counseled, and I quote, "Wherever we are, we must all in our daily lives live up to the age-old faith that peace and freedom walk together. In too many of our cities today, peace is not secure because freedom is incomplete. And I am talking about the kind of peace that enables man and nations to grow and to hope and to build a better life for their children. Not merely peace for Americans, but peace for all men and women. Not merely peace in our time, but peace for all time." This forum event would not have been possible without the support and guidance of Holly Davidson, the chairwoman and founder of the ILEX Foundation, an organization that promotes the study of the civilizations of the Mediterranean and Near East. We owe her an immense amount of gratitude. I would like also to thank my colleagues at the forum for their immense efforts to make tonight's address a seamless and meaningful undertaking. Although tonight's lecture marks the close of the 2003-04 forum season, it also heralds a new era for the Kennedy School. Just 3 weeks ago, Dr. David Elwood was named the next dean of the Kennedy School, and we are extremely honored that he is joining us this evening to introduce our distinguished speaker. As one of the nation's most influential scholars of poverty, welfare, and family change, Dr. Elwood has been a member of the Kennedy School faculty since 1980 and has twice served as academic dean. A graduate of Harvard College who received a PhD in economics, also from Harvard, in 1981, Dr. Elwood has also played a leading role in the policy arena, most prominently in the mid-1990s as a senior official in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and a central figure in welfare reform. He has also been involved in exploring both poverty and the policy processes in several countries around the world. In the words of Harvard President Larry Summers, Dr. Elwood is deeply dedicated to the well-being of the Kennedy School and its robust engagement with the larger world in an era of exceptional challenge in the U.S. and abroad. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I present to you the 8th Dean of the John F. Kennedy School of Government, Dr. David Elwood.
Hello, everyone, and welcome. Welcome especially to those of you that, for whom this may be your first time in the forum or at the Kennedy School and so forth, those of you from the Iranian community and larger communities, let it not be your last. We have much to learn from each other and many opportunities to grow together. It's a unique pleasure for me. This is my first forum event since being named Dean of the Kennedy School. And as Elaine mentioned, it's the last event of the season. So this is both an ending and a beginning, and I cannot imagine a better person to represent those two things. And so it is my enormous pleasure to welcome Shirin Ebadi to the Kennedy School. because for more than 25 years, she has been a tireless champion of human rights and justice and injustice in Iran. She is, in her own words, a friend of the powerless, the voice of the voiceless. Her voice has become, of course, much more widely known around the world now when she received the Nobel Peace Prize in October of 2003, the first Iranian and the first Muslim woman to be so honored. It is an enormous honor to have such a person here at the Kennedy School. Shireen Ebadi first gained prominence while serving as one of Iran's first female judges, serving as the president of the city court of Tehran from 1975 to 1979. She supported the Iranian Revolution, but was nonetheless forced to resign her judgeship when women were banned from the judiciary under the new government. Since that time, she's practiced law and become an advocate for women and children, along with refugee rights. In 1994, Ebadi helped found the Society for the Protection of the Rights of the Child, an organization that has lobbied parliament and fought for reforms in Iranian family law that would protect children and empower women. She's taken on very many high-profile cases, ranging from the families of murdered writers and intellectuals to attacks on students. Her works gained her a great deal of admiration, but also powerful enemies. Indeed, she was imprisoned and placed in solitary confinement as recently as 2000. One of the most striking features, as I've read through the work, and many of you as well, of Ebadi's work is its learned connection to reformed Islam. Far from rejecting Islam in her Nobel Prize acceptance speech and in every address that I've heard of hers, she talks about how the message of Islam cannot be in conflict with awareness, knowledge, wisdom, freedom of opinion and expression, and pluralism. Her writing and advocacy in the support of the rights of children draws repeatedly on both Iranian legal traditions and progressive Islamic traditions. And Ebadi herself is an example of a principle she champions and that we at the school champion, that is the powerful effect of educating women. According to Ebadi, a sizable majority of students entering the university in Iran are now women. And she says, they see that the prevailing laws are not suitable for conditions that are emerging. Because so many women are protesting against their conditions, things will improve. Ebadi's powerful voice is raised when she sees justice, injustice and human rights concerns elsewhere. And indeed, in her Nobel Prize address, she worried that Western nations may restrict human rights and basic freedoms, quote, under the cloak of war on terrorism. And she cautions that human rights cannot be exported with bullets and bombs. Her words and her deeds reveal the remarkable influence of courageous and forceful voices calling us to remember our basic values. She shows us the singular power of learned women. And most of all, at a time of frankly great trauma and worry to many of us throughout the world, she reveals that there is hope in recognizing our common humanity and respect for each other. She concluded her Nobel speech with a warning and a prescription. She says, if the 21st century wishes to free itself of the cycle of violence, acts of terror, and avoid repetition of the experience of the 20th century, that most disaster-ridden century of humankind, there is no other way except by understanding and putting into practice every human right for all mankind, irrespective of race, gender, faith, nationality, or social status. Ms. Ebadi, we are not off to a very good start in this century. I hope and trust your words will lead us to a more hopeful future. With that, let's all welcome Shireen Ebadi.
That is عالی جنابان، اساتید محترم، همکاران ارجمند، دانشجویان عزیز، حضار گرامی، خانم ها و آقایان، بسیار خوشبختم که امروز در جمع شما هستم.
Excellencies, distinguished professors, distinguished colleagues, dear students, distinguished participants, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very pleased to be with you today.
دانشگاه محل بحث و تبادل نظره و از این رو اجازه میخوام که به یک پرسش اساسی در عصر حاضر بپردازم و آن این که آیا بهبود زندگی انسانها و مفاهیمی چون توسعه اقتصادی، حقوق بشر، خوشبختی و نظایر آن بدون دموکراسی امکان پذیر است؟
A university is a venue for the exchange of ideas. Therefore, I would like to begin by asking a question. Is democracy achievable at a time when human rights, economic development, the prosperity of humanity, and similar values are disregarded?
به عبارت دیگر، آیا دموکراسی پیش شرط هر نوع تحول مثبت اجتماعی و دروازه خوشبختی است یا خیر؟
In other words, is democracy a prerequisite for every positive social development and a gate for the furtherance of human prosperity or not?
نگاهی به تاریخ بیندازی. انقلاب اکتبر روسیه که منجر به تأسیس اتحاد جماهیر شوروی شد، با نیت فقر زدائی، بست عدالت اجتماعی، رفع بحران بیکاری، رفاه بیشتر و در یک کلام خوشبختی انسان به وقوع پیوست.
Let us take a look at history, at the October Revolution in Russia, which led to the establishment of the Soviet Union, which came about with the intention to eradicate poverty, to enhance social justice, to put an end to the unemployment crisis, to create greater welfare, and in short, to create prosperity for humanity.
روزی که لنین قدرت را در اختیار گرفت، مسلماً جز به سربلندی وطن خیش و خوشبختی هموطنانش نمی اندیشید و در این راه از چیزی مضایقه نکرد. حتی حاضر شد 2 میلیون نفر را به کشتن بده تا روسیه ای آباد بر ویرانه های تزاری بنا کنه.
No doubt, when Lenin took over power, it was with the intention to give a higher status to his country and to his people and more prosperity. That was the sole thing on his mind, probably, and he was ready to do anything, even if it meant the killing of more than 2 million people in order to create a more prosperous Russia over the ruins of Tsarist Russia.
استالین نیز جز خوشبختی انسان اندیشه‌ای نداشت و برای حصول به این هدف صدها هزار تن را اعدام کرد و یا به سیبری تبعید کرد.
Stalin too had human prosperity for his people in mind, and to achieve that, he executed hundreds of thousands of his own people or forced many others into exile in Siberia.
اما آیا مردم اتحاد جماهیر شوروی خوشبخت بودند؟ از زندگی خود راضی بودند؟ مسلما خیر، زیرا اگر جز این بود بعد از 70 سال شاهد فروپاشی شوروی نبودیم.
However, let us ask, were the people of the Soviet Republic prosperous? Were people satisfied with their lives? Obviously not, because if this were the case, the Soviet Union would not have collapsed after 70 years.
مردمی که از حکومت خود راضی باشند با چنگ و دندان از آن حراست کرده و اجازه نمی دهند سرنوشتی چون اتحاد جماهیر شوروی بر آنها حاکم شود.
People who are satisfied with their form of government will defend it by any means and will not allow their country to witness a similar fate to that of the Soviet Union.
هیتلر که به قدرت رسید با حربه نژاد برتر آلمانی قصد داشت آلمان را به بزرگترین قدرت جهان تبدیل کرده و همه نعمت‌های دنیا را تقدیم آلمانی‌ها کند.
When Hitler assumed power in Germany, he used the excuse to create a higher status for the German race and for his people, to create a bigger, wealthier, more prosperous country that would benefit from all the bounties of the world.
هرچند او نیز در قساوت افسانه شد و اردوگاه‌های او ننگ بشریت شد، ولی آلمانی‌ها هرگز خوشبخت نشدند.
His atrocities too were legendary, and his concentration camps a scar on the face of humanity. And as we know, the Germans never prospered.
موسولینی هم هدفی جز سربلندی ایتالیا و ایجاد رفاه برای هموطنانش نداشت. حاضر شد جوانهای بسیاری را بکشتن دهد و خود نیز بر سر این سودا جان داد، اما ایتالیایی ها را هم نتوانست خوشبخت کند.
Mussolini too intended to create a higher status for his nation, to create more welfare for his people. He too was willing to let many young people die, and he too lost his life in that cause. However, the Italians did not prosper under his government.
چه کاستی در لنین، هیتلر و موسولینی بود که این چنین مورد نفرت همگان حتی هموطنان خیش قرار گرفتند.
What did Lenin, Hitler and Mussolini lack that would lead for their fellow compatriots and all humanity to hate them as such?
مگر نه اینکه آنها قصد خوشبختی بشر و ایجاد رفاه بیشتر برای انسان‌ها را داشتند، پس چرا این چنین منفور بودند تا حدی که حتی برخی از بهترین ادبا و عالم‌ترین دانشمندان به جرم همکاری با هیتلر از جامعه روشنفکران طرد شدند؟
Was it not that they sought to create prosperity and better welfare for their people? But then if that was the case, why were they so despised to the point that some of the best literary men of their times and best intellectuals and scientists were shunned by their societies for actually complying with Hitler's commands and his system of governance?
نکته مهم اینجاست. آنها قصد نداشتند هموطنان خود را در بدبختی قوطه ور سازند. اگر انقلابی اتفاق افتاد، اگر جنگی شروع شد، اگر انسانها را کشتند، اگر بیرحمی ها کردند، اما نیت آنها خیر بود، نیت آنها بهبودی وضعیت بشر بود، اما موفق نشدند.
The key point is that they did not wish to inflict pain and misfortune on their people. If there was a revolution, or if there was a war, or even if people were killed and heinous crimes were committed, it was with good intentions in their minds, the intent to bring about welfare for their people. But they did not succeed.
زیرا به یک اصل مهم بی‌توجه بودند. و آن دموکراسی و احترام به اراده آزاد مردم بود.
The reason was that they neglected a key principle, that being the need to respect the free will of people and democracy.
کمونیست‌های شوروی با زور می‌خواستند مردم را خوشبخت کنند و خوشبختی اجباری نیست.
The communists in the former Soviet Union wanted to bring prosperity to their people by force, and prosperity cannot be imposed.
هیتلر با زور می‌خواست آلمانی‌ها را تبدیل به انسان‌های برتر سازد و برتری با زور و اجبار ممکن نیست.
Hitler wanted to bestow or endow a higher status by force on his people. But this higher status also is not achievable by force.
اشتباهی که برخی از حکومت‌های مذهبی در حال حاضر می‌کنند. با زور می‌خواهند مردم را به بهشت ببرند. بهشت اجباری بدتر از جهنم است.
The mistake that some religious governments make is that they want to take their people to heaven by force. But a heaven forced on you is hell.
با این مقدمه قصد دارم نگاهی به سیاست خارجی دولت آمریکا بیاندازم.
With this introduction, I would like to take a look at the foreign policy of the United States.
اخیراً گفته می شود که دخالت آمریکا در عراق و باقی ماندن سربازان آمریکایی در کشور عراق برای برقراری دموکراسی و استقرار حقوق بشر در آن کشور است.
It is said that the US intervention in Iraq and the presence of US soldiers in that country is with the purpose of establishing democracy and human rights.
در اینکه صدام دیکتاتوری بود که در راه ابقاء قدرت خیش از هر جنایتی رویگردان نبود حرفی نیست. مسلماً سقوط چنین دیکتاتوری آرزوی هر انسان آزادی خواهی است و بدیهی است که کسی از سقوط وی نیز غمگین نشد.
There is no question that Saddam was a dictator who in order to remain in power committed the most heinous crimes. And undoubtedly there were many people who were hoping for his overthrow, many freedom seeking people who hoped that he would be be overthrown. And there is no doubt that no one was saddened by the news of his overthrow.
اما حمله نظامی به یک کشور به بهانه استقرار دموکراسی روی دیگر سکه است که توصیفش را قبلا کردم، یعنی بازور مردم را خوشبخت کردن و مردمی که آزاد نباشند خوشبخت نخواهند بود.
However, a military attack on a country in the name of establishing democracy represents the other side of the coin which I touched upon earlier. That is to say, to force prosperity on people who are not free is not possible. People who are not free will not feel prosperous.
دموکراسی یک حادثه نیست که یک شب اتفاق افتد.
Democracy is not an event that can happen overnight.
دموکراسی هدیه ای نیست که در سینی طلا به کسی پیشکش کنند.
Democracy is not a gift that can be delivered on a golden platter.
دموکراسی یک پروسه تاریخی است. باید سیر تکاملی خود را طی کند.
Democracy is a historical process that needs to reach maturity over time.
اگر کشوری مدعی است، بر فرض که در ادعای خود صادق باشد، که قصد حمایت از دموکراسی در کشور استبداد زده ای را دارد، تنها راه آن حمایت معنوی از افراد آزادیخواه و نهادهای دموکراتیک آن کشور است تا هرچه سریعتر نهال دموکراسی به بار نشسته و گل آزادی را برمغان آورد.
If a country claims, and assuming that they are genuine in their claim, that it seeks to give democracy to an oppressed nation and country, then the only way to do that is to provide spiritual support to freedom-seeking people and democratic institutions of a country, so that the seeds of democracy there are also sown and that it grows.
حمله نظامی ولو با نیت استقرار دموکراسی و حقوق بشر نه تنها به روند دموکراسی صدمه میزند بلکه به چرخه تولید خشونت نیز مبدل میگردد.
Military intervention, even with the intention of establishing democracy and human rights, will not only hurt the democratic process, but will also turn into violence.
زیرا هر رفتار خشنی واکنش خشنتری را به دنبال دارد. خشونت مصری است.
Every violent action results in further violence. Violence is contaminates and is contagious.
و این چنین است که می‌بینیم متأسفانه سربازان آمریکایی فرزندان شما در عراق کشته می‌شوند. و سوی دیگر با کمال تأسف با زندانیان عراقی رفتاری می‌کنند که شرم‌آور است.
And it is as such that regretfully we see that American soldiers are killed, your children, in Iraq, and most regrettably that Iraqi prisoners are mistreated in a shameful manner.
شما را کمی عقب‌تر می‌برم به پایان جنگ جهانی دوم زمانی که انسان‌ها شرمنده از اعمال خود در جنگ جهانی به این فکر افتادند که از جنگ دیگری جلوگیری کنند حقوقدانان فلاسفه و متفکرین جهان گرد هم آمدند و اعلامیه جهانی حقوق بشر را نوشتند
Let me take you back to history a bit to the end of World War II when human being embarrassed by its actions over the course of this world war decided to prevent war in the future and when philosophers and lawyers and intellectuals around the world gathered to draft a universal declaration for human rights
در مقدمه اعلامیه آمده است که چون عدم شناسایی و تحقیر حقوق بشر موجب طغیان انسان‌ها و منتهی به اعمال وحشیانه ای خواهد شد لذا دولت‌ها متعهد می‌شوند که حقوق بشر را به رسمیت شناخته و در اجرای آن مجاهدت کنند
In its preamble to paraphrase it says that since the non-recognition of human rights and the belittlement of human dignity will lead to the uprising of the people and the furtherance of violence Therefore, states undertake to recognize and uphold human rights.
در گردآوردن متفکران و همچنین تدوین این اعلامیه خانم روزولت نقشی بسیار مهم داشت تا حدی که نام وی در کنار اعلامیه حقوق بشر در تاریخ ثبت و حک شده است.
Mrs. Eleanor Roosevelt was a key player in gathering these thinkers and intellectuals and in the drafting of the Universal Declaration. And her name remains in history as such.
و اکنون فرزندان این زن سیاستمداران فعلی آمریکا به شیوه‌ای رفتار می‌کنند که تمام زحمات او را برباد دادند.
However, the children of this dignified lady, the current statesmen in this country, are behaving in a manner that actually undermines all her efforts.
و بابت تصمیماتی که گرفتند و اعمالی که انجام دادند باید از روح بزرگ این زن آمریکایی معذرت خواهی کنند.
They must seek forgiveness from this great American woman for their actions and its consequences.
می توان از خشونت پرهیز کرد.
One can refrain from violence.
عاقلانه نیست که بخواهیم به جای ملتی تفکر کرده و آینده را برای آنان رقم زنیم.
It is unwise to think for a nation and to determine their future for them.
فراموش نکنیم با زور نمیتوان کسی را خوشبخت کرد.
Let us not forget that one cannot make anyone prosperous by force.
با اسلحه نمیتوان دموکراسی صادر کرد.
One cannot export or expand democracy with guns.
با بمب‌های خوشه‌ای نمیتوان حقوق بشر بر سر ملتی ریخت.
One cannot throw human rights over a nation with shrapnels.
دموکراسی و حقوق بشر جز با خواست مردم تحقق نمی‌یابد.
Democracy and human rights will not be achieved unless it is by the will of the people.
کشورهایی که مدعی دلسوزی برای حقوق بشر هستند باید ابتداعا از طریق مذاکره و سپس از مجرای سازمان ملل متحد دولت‌های متجاوز را به احترام به حقوق بشر وادارند.
Countries that claim to sympathize with the ideals of human rights must first seek to negotiate over those rights and then take it to the United Nations forum to make the non-complying states respect human rights.
اگر قرار است تنبیهی صورت گیرد باید توسط سازمان ملل متحد باشد. در آن صورت است که مبارزه برای دموکراسی و آزادی مشروعیت یافته و قابل دفاع است.
If there is to be any corrective measure, it has to be done through the United Nations, and it is only then that democracy and freedom become legitimate causes and therefore defendable.
با آرزوی قدرت بیشتر برای سازمان ملل متحد سخنان خود را خاتمه داده و امیدوارم به زودی اداره کشور عراق تحت نظارت سازمان ملل متحد به مردم عراق سپرده شود و سربازان آمریکایی فرزندان شما سالم و تندرست به خانه و آشیانه خود برگردند.
I would like to end my remarks by hoping that the United Nations will in fact become more strengthened and that the administration of Iraq would be left to the people of Iraq through the supervision of the United Nations so that American soldiers, your children, can return home healthy and wealthy.
Thanks.
Ms. Abadé has agreed to take questions, and there are four microphones around the auditorium here. And I'd just like to remind the audience that the best questions are brief, and they end with a question mark. So with that, let me open up for the audience, and we will ask the first question, and maybe I'll just recognize one here, and we'll just go around the room.
Before World War II, Japan was not a democracy and not especially prosperous. And after American invasion and occupation, it became a prosperous democracy. And I was wondering how that fits within the framework that you have just described.
وضعیت ژاپن کاملا با عراق تفاوت داره.
Japan's situation is completely different with Iraq.
در ژاپن دیکتاتوری به صورتی که در عراق جریان داشت جریان نداشت.
Japan did not have a a dictatorship that was similar to the dictatorship in Iraq.
در اونجا امپراتوری بود که مردم حتی جرأت نداشتند به روش نگاه کنند چون پسر خدا می‌دانستندش. اما این فرق داشت با وضعیت عراق که با شکنجه و زندان مردم را وادار به اطاعت می‌کردند.
In Japan, there was an emperor who people did not have the right to even look to, because he was considered to be the son of God. In Iraq, we had a dictator who through torture and through imprisonment forced his people to comply with his will.
ژاپن زمینه‌های پیشرفت توسعه صنعتی رو قبل از جنگ هم داشت و بسیار پیشرفته‌تر از عراق زمان صدام بود.
Even prior to World War II, Japan had the infrastructure for infrastructure for industrial development, which Iraq lacked under Saddam's dictatorship.
در ژاپن یک روز بر سر مردم بمب اتمی ریختند و بعد دیگه تقریبا ولشون کردند و حالا که عراق را هر روز پدرش رو در میاره.
They threw an atomic bomb over Japan and then left it alone. But in Iraq, they're throwing bombs day and night over the people of Iraq and making them miserable by the hour.
The Iranian people have been calling for a referendum to determine the form of their future government. Do you support such a referendum? And if so, when do you envision it?
من همواره حامی دموکراسی هستم. دموکراسی یعنی خواست مردم. و هر زمان که مردم در این خواست اکثریت پیدا بکنند، همواره موفق خواهند شد.
I have always supported democracy, and democracy means the will of the people. And the will of the people can be carried out whenever there is a majority voice behind it.
البته گاهی از اوقات موانعی پیش میاد که خواست اکثریت نمیتواند جامعه تحقق به خود بگیرد.
Of course, there are certainly times when various hurdles prevent the will of the majority to become realized within a society.
و اون زمانی است که آزادی بیان در کشوری صدمه می‌خوره.
And that is when the freedom of speech is hurt in a country.
و مردم نمی‌توانند خواسته‌های مشروع خودشون رو آزادانه اعلام بکنند.
And when people cannot demand their legitimate rights freely.
مبارزه برای تحقق دموکراسی و آزادی بیان بر عهده تک تک افراد یک کشوره.
Fighting to realize democracy and the freedom of speech is on the people, individual, each and every person in a country.
Up here.
You say that America cannot legitimately enforce democracy in a nation. Do you believe that the UN or the international community can legitimately do that?
مصوبات سازمان ملل متحد نشان از خرد جمعی بین المللی دارد.
The thinking in the various declarations, etc., that have been passed throughout time by the United Nations reflect a collective wisdom.
بهترین راه برای حفظ صلح در جهان گردن نهادن به مصوبات سازمان ملل متحده.
The best way to protect freedom and human rights in the world is to accept the rulings of the United Nations and its decisions.
وظیفه هر انسان آزادی خواهی در هر کجای جهان این است که کمک به تقویت سازمان ملل متحد بکنه.
It is incumbent upon every freedom-seeking person throughout the world to help strengthen the United Nations.
و متاسفانه دولت آمریکا در این راه گام بر نمی‌دارد.
And regretfully, the United States government have failed to take positive steps in this direction.
Hi, thanks for being here. Would the presence of an Islamic democracy in the Middle East accelerate change in other states, in other Islamic states in the Middle East?
من اول بگم با لفظ دموکراسی اسلامی موافق نیستم. دموکراسی دموکراسی در شرق و غرب فرق داره.
Let me first say that I disagree with the term Islamic democracy. Democracy is democracy whether in the East or the West.
و طبیعی است که در جهان امروز سرنوشت بشریت آنچنان به هم گره خورده که هر اتفاقی در گوشه ای از جهان میتواند در بقیه نقاط جهان دیگر مؤثر باشد.
Naturally, in today's world, the fate of humanity is so interlinked that any event or activity in one part of the world will inevitably affect the rest of the world.
This being my first formal event as a new dean, have neglected to ask that people identify themselves before they ask their statement ending with a question. So if you would identify yourself and...
I'm Maral Shamlu, a first-year MPAID student here at the Kennedy School. Ms. Abadi, given your expertise and the fact that you've devoted your career to promoting freedom for Iranians for the past 25 years, I would like to know why you have concentrated on criticizing the U.S.'s foreign policy in your speeches recently. Wouldn't it be fair to expect to hear some criticisms or some mentioning of the failures of our own government, and I can say our own government because I'm Iranian.
دختر عزیزم، هر بلندگویی مطلبی رو طلب میکنه.
My dearest daughter, every platform demands a certain statement.
من اینجا در آمریکا هستم. مخاطبین من بیشتر آمریکایی هستند.
I'm in the United States and my interlocutors, my participants, the people present here are mostly Americans.
من باید قسمتی از حقوق بشر رو که برای جامعه آمریکایی قابل لمس‌تره عنوان بکنم.
I must discuss human rights in a manner the part of which also impacts the Americans for which with which they can associate.
راجع به نقض حقوق بشر در ایران من به کرات صحبت کردم، خصوصا در ایران با وجود مخاطراتی که هست.
I've spoken on many occasions about the violation of human rights in Iran, inside Iran, also with granted that there are also dangers when I've spoken.
به عنوان مثال، من وکیل ناصر زرافشان هستم. ناصر زرافشان وکیل مدافعی است که به علت دفاع از یک پرونده به 5 سال حبس محکوم شده که الان 1.5 سال در زندانه.
For example, I defend a client, Nasser Zarafshan. He is a defense attorney who is undergoing a 5-year prison sentence. He's gone through the first year and a half only for taking on a special case.
من میتونم ساعت‌ها راجع به پرونده ناصر زرافشان اینجا صحبت بکنم، ولیکن واقعا فکر میکنید همه این هزار علاقه بشیدن به شنیدن این کیس دارن و حوصله‌شون سر نمیره؟
I can speak for hours about Nasser Zarafshan's case, but don't you think that it's beyond the patience of this respected audience?
Thank you.
Can identify yourself.
Thank you. I'm Dania Cato. I'm a graduate student at the School of Public Health. The title of today's lecture is Islam, Human Rights, and Democracy, and we've heard a lot about human rights and democracy, and I was hoping if you can talk a little bit about what Islam means to you, and also what it means vis-a-vis human rights and democracy. Thank you.
اسلام مدت هاست از دو سو مورد سوء استفاده قرار میگیره.
For long, Islam has been taken advantage of from two fronts.
یکی از سوی برخی از حکومت های اسلامی که به نام اسلام به مردم اچاف میکنند.
On one front, it is on the part of some Islamic governments who, in the name of Islam, seek to violate the rights of their people.
اینها عنوان میکنند.
To neglect their rights.
اینها عنوان میکنند که اسلام با حقوق بشر و دموکراسی مغایرت دارد و بدین ترتیب بر تجاوز خودشون بر حقوق ملت مسکی از فرهنگ میزنن.
They state that human rights and democracy are incompatible with Islam and therefore seek to violate the rights of their people under the guise of a certain way of culture, I believe is what Ms. Abadi has said.
اینها افکار خودشون رو به نام اسلام به خورد مردم میدن و هر نوع انتقاد از حکومت را مساوی انتقاد از اسلام قلمداد میکنن.
They force their opinions on the people and maintain that any defense of human rights or any is the equivalent of criticizing Islam.
اینها ماسکی از فرهنگ به صورت زدن و به نام فرهنگ ملی یا دینی به حقوق مردم تجاوز میکنن.
They wear a cultural mask, whether it's cultural or national or what they name, and seek to violate the rights of their people with that name.
و متاسفانه اسلام از سوی دیگر نیز مورد سوء استفاده قرار میگیره.
Regretfully, Islam has also been taken advantage of from another front.
ادعی که منافع خود را در شعله‌های جنگ جستجو می‌کنند، روش غلط چند تن یا چند گروه را عین اسلام معرفی می‌کنند و می‌گویند اسلام یعنی این.
The people who seek to impose their interests through warfare and go on to say that the actions of a certain group of individuals or a limited number of people represents what they know as Islam.
و عنوان میکنن که تمدن های شرقی خصوصا تمدن اسلامی با تمدن غربی در ستیزه.
And go further on to say that Eastern civilizations, specifically that is to say mainly Islamic civilization, is incompatible with Western civilization and principles.
اینها خطای انسانها رو به پای دین و مذهبی می نویسند که بدان تعلق دارند، خصوصا اگر مسلمان باشه خطاکار.
They choose to say that the human mistakes that happen represent what their religion has told them to be. And specifically, if that were to be Islam by any chance, they make sure to focus on that.
و بدین گونه است که شما میبینید از واژگانی نظیر تروریسم اسلامی استفاده میکنند.
And this is why you see a growth in certain words such as Islamic terrorism.
اسلام دینی است که با ترور و خشونت مخالفه.
Islam is a religion that opposes terror and violence.
اگر انسان بیگناهی کشته شد، بدانید از نام اسلام سوء استفاده کردند.
If an innocent human being is killed, you should know that the name of Islam has been taken advantage of for that cause.
آنچنان که خطای تنی چند در جنگ بوسنی رو ما به حساب مسیحیت ننوشتیم که مسیح پیامبر خداست.
When the violence erupted in Bosnia, we did not come out to say that it was because of Christianity. Christ was the messenger of God.
و نادیده گرفتن قطعنامه‌های متعدد سازمان ملل متحد از سوی دولت اسرائیل را ما به پای دین یهود نمی نویسیم که موسی پیامبر خدا و منادی حق و عدالت است.
If the Israeli government chooses to ignore numerous United Nations resolutions, we do not blame it on Judaism and the Jewish faith. Moses was also the messenger of God.
بنابراین سوال من این است، چرا خطای یک فرد مسلمان رو به نام اسلام می نویسید و می گویید تروریسم اسلامی؟
So my question to you. My question to you, to everyone, is why do we blame Islam for the mistake of one Muslim individual or group and come up with terms such as Islamic terrorism?
Hi, my name is Mitra Dolatshai. I'm a sophomore at the college. There are many Iranian officials who believe that the Nobel Committee committed undue interference in Iran's affair by honoring you with the Peace Prize. How would you respond to them?
از کمیته نوبل سوال کنی.
You should ask the Nobel Committee.
Hello. My name is Barbara Roshan. I'm with the Women in Public Policy program here at the Kennedy School. And as the first Muslim woman to receive this honor, do you intend and how do you intend to promote women's roles in peace building throughout the Middle East and throughout the world?
Zanon dar gostaresh sol dar jahan naqsh umdei daran.
Women play an important role in promoting peace in the world. First, they are effective as a citizen.
And second,
in their capacity as mothers, in raising a generation that will determine the future of a society.
Sol یک بخشنامه نیست که در سن 40 سالگی مثلا به رئیس جمهوری بشه دیکته کرد.
Peace is not a sort of declaration that can be recommended to a president of a country at the age of 40 when he reaches 40, for example.
Sol یک فرهنگ اعتقاد قلبی کسی است به مسالمت و تحمل صدای مخالف.
Peace is an inner belief. It is a culture. It is the belief in tolerance that it can exist and become part of the humanity's message.
و مادران. و مادران در اشاعه این فرهنگ نقش بسیار مهمی دارند.
And mothers play an extremely important role in promoting this culture.
و از این رو تحصیلات برای زنان با ارزش‌تر است حتی برای مردان.
This is why education for women is even more important than education for men.
My name is Richard Fry, Iran Dust. I'm a retired dinosaur. You must excuse me. I must ask this question in Persian because it doesn't sound right in English. Chera der Irani imruz, dad, dad gadimi Irani, dad gustari, bedini Islami, din gustari, Tabdil should.
Could I ask you to translate the question?
The question, I'll do my best, but feel free to correct me. The question is, why is it that in modern day Iran, the role of the prosecutor, if you translate the term in English, it means the person who seeks to attain justice for a society has turned into a person or a group that seeks to promote religion rather than justice?
جانا سخن از زبان ما میگویی
Mrs. Ebadi is referring to a piece of Persian poetry that says you're speaking from our heart
فقط میتونم بگم مسلما من مقصر نیستم
All I can say is that undoubtedly I'm not responsible for it
Hi, my name is Azadeh Tehranian. Before I ask my question, I just want to emphasize that my question is not meant to undermine your remarkable efforts for all women and children in our beloved country. I guess every true Iranian is proud of what you did, and they owe you a great deal of appreciation. I exactly quote from the Quran, the holy book of Muslims. Surah 4, verse 38. Men are the managers of the affairs of women, for that God has preferred in bounty one of them over another. And those you fear may be rebellious, admonish, banish them to their couches, and beat them. My question is, how could you say there is no conflict between Islam and human rights?
این سوال رو بارها و بارها از من کردن خوشحالم که یه بار دیگه الان بهش جواب بدم.
They've asked this question from me on numerous times and I'm glad that you raise it in this forum too.
تمرد زن از شوهرش در عربستان در زمان جاهلیت مجازات بسیار سنگینی داشت. معادل کشتن و قتل.
If I'm translating the word tamarud correctly, if the women in ancient Saudi Arabia chose to neglect what the husband's ruling was, she would have been punished in those days, and the punishment would have been equivalent to her death at times.
و اسلام که به نسبت فرهنگ 14 قرن قبل به زنان اهمیت زیادی میداد در این مسئله تعدیل کرد.
یعنی فکر کردش یا
کمش
کردش. So Islam, which came about 14 centuries ago and was reflective of the culture of its time, tried to relativize this issue.
مجازات زن رو تازیانه که یکی از مجازات‌های متداول زمان 14 قرن قبل بود تعیین کرد اما نه اینکه شوهر خودش اجرا بکنه بلکه قاضی بعد از پس از رسیدگی حق داشته باشه این مجازات رو در مورد زن متمرد اعمال بکنه
So it determined that the beating of the wife would be the punishment in that case, but that it must not be carried not by the husband, but by a judge who would see to the case and then determine whether that beating was possible, necessary or not.
اما من میخوام کمی بیشتر راجع به قواعدی که در قرآن هست با شما صحبت کنم.
Allow me to talk a bit more about the principles in the Quran.
برخی از قوانینی که میگن مربوط به اسلامه اصلا در قرآن ذکری از اونها نیست.
Some rules that are attached to Islam as being Islamic principles have not even been mentioned in the Quran.
مثل سنگسار که اصلا در قرآن نیست.
For example, the stoning of women, which does not exist in the Quran.
اما برخی از احکام دیگر صراحتا در قرآن قید شده.
Other rules, regulations have been explicitly stated in the Quran.
مثل همین چیزی که الان سوال کردید.
just like what you questioned right now.
آنچه که در قرآن هست بهش میگن احکام اولیه.
The principles in the Quran are known as the first principles, first regular rules of a primary. Thank you.
من مثالی میزنم در مورد روزه.
I'll bring an example, fasting.
در ماه رمضان یک مسلمان بایستی روزه بگیره، یعنی از طلوع آفتاب تا غروب آفتاب چیزی نخوره و نیاشامه.
Throughout Ramadan, a Muslim woman must fast from sunrise to sundown and not eat anything or drink anything.
این یک دستوره که در قرآن آمده و اجراش البته در عربستان آسانه.
This is a rule that has been mentioned in the Quran, and of course it's simple to follow in Saudi Arabia.
برای اینکه طلوع و غروب آفتاب مشخصه.
Because sunrise and sunset are clear.
اما اگر یک مسلمان رفت در قطب شمال که شش ماه شب بود و شش ماه روز بود چه باید بکنه؟
But what should a Muslim do if he or she ends up in the North Pole where 6 months of the year are dark and 6 months light?
اگر روزه بگیره یعنی شش ماه غذا نخوره که میمیره.
If they decide to fast and not eat for 6 months, they'll die.
و اگر روزه نگیره یک دستور الهی رو اجرا نکرده.
And if they fail to fast, then they have neglected divine law.
بنابراین یک راه حل سومی بایستی وجود داشته باشه.
So there must be a third solution to this problem.
این راه حل سوم رو خود اسلام به ما نشون میده.
Islam itself tells us what this third solution is.
و اسمش احکام ثانویه است.
Through secondary regulations and laws.
زمانی که احکام اولیه به هر دلیلی از جمله تغییر زمان و شرایط زمانی و مکانی قابل اجرا نباشد بایستی احکام ثانویه بیاد.
When primary laws shift either through because of time or because of changes in location and time, then secondary laws and regulations come in.
احکام ثانویه یعنی اینکه با توجه به روح کلیه قرآن چیزی شبیه به آنچه که هست اما قابل اجرا بیاید.
Secondary laws mean seeking guidance through the general spirit of the Quran and finding solutions in a way that are achievable and practical.
مثلا در روزه که مثال زدم حکم ثانویه‌اش به این صورته که میگن شبانه روز رو به 3-8 ساعت تقسیم میکنیم. در 1-8 ساعت که مسلمان خواب نیست چیزی نمیخوره، نمیآشامه و میشه این روزه.
For example, the same secondary rules determine in the case of fasting that one can divide a day and night into three 8-hour time limits. And the first one that could be the daylight is when the Muslim should refrain from eating and therefore fast.
با این ترتیب ببینیم الان یک قاعده سخت قابل اجرا شد.
So as we can see, a difficult ordinance or law it becomes practical and easy to manage.
و بسیاری از مسائلی که هست در فقه اسلامی به همین صورت قابل تعبیر و تفسیر است.
There are many other laws in Islamic fiqh or jurisprudence that can be interpreted in the same manner.
تاریخ اسلام از این احکام ثانویه زیاد داره.
If you look into the history of Islam, there are numerous examples of these secondary laws.
من به یکیش اشاره میکنم. آزاد شدن موسیقی. موسیقی قبلا حرام بود و حالا آزاده.
I'll just name one. The freedom now to listen or use or play music. It used to not be allowed. It would be permissible, whereas now it is. It was haram, in other words, in the old days.
اما سوال اصلی اینه. که چرا راجع به حقوق زن در تاریخ اسلام از احکام ثانوی استفاده نمیشه.
So the key question here is why don't we refer to secondary laws when it comes to the rights of the women?
این به خاطر این به خاطر این نیست که اسلام اجازه نمیده بلکه فرهنگ مرد سالار حاکم بر کشورهای اسلامی که اجازه نمیده
This is not because it is not permissible by through Islam. It is because of the patriarchal culture that overrides the will of the people in Islamic societies.
There are time for just three more questions.
Good afternoon. My name is Nakia Jackson. I'm a junior at Berkeley. First of all, you're one of my heroines. And second of all, unfortunately, even in democracies, the rights of minorities have often been neglected. How can we keep hatred from the mighty, or at least the mighty from the small?
Could you repeat the second part of your question, please?
Unfortunately, even in democracies, the rights of minorities have often been neglected. How can we keep hatred from the mighty, or at least the mighty from the small?
سوال خوبیه. دموکراسی و حقوق بشر توامن بایستی با هم به کار گرفته بشه.
This is a good question. Democracy and human rights should walk hand in hand and be practiced together.
دموکراسی یعنی حکومت اکثریت.
Democracy is the rule of the majority.
اما اکثریت حق نداره هر کاری که دلش خواست بکنه.
But that does not mean that the majority can do whatever it pleases.
به حقوق اقلیت نیز بایستی احترام بگذاره.
It must also respect the rights of the minorities.
و چارچوبش به وسیله حقوق بشر مشخص میشه.
The framework of which is determined through the principles of human rights.
و از سوی دیگر حقوق بشر فقط به وسیله دموکراسی قابل اعماله، نه با زور.
And on the other hand, human rights is, can be practiced only through democracy and not by force.
وقتی که این دو تا با هم باشن جامعه خوشبخته.
So only when these two go hand in hand is a society and truly prosperous.
Up there.
Thank you, Shireen Abadi. My name is Selma Hassan, and I'm from the Sudan. I'm also an international development student here at the Kennedy School. My question is with reference to Sudan. Ever since 1989, a minority of Sudanese imposed their own unusual interpretation of Islamic law onto the people. My question to you is, how do we as citizens of these countries that have undergone this process, how do we fight when the so-called sheikhs or the so-called Islamic leaders of our country who have their dogmatic views and who cannot separate what is ritual and tradition from what is religion and call any deviation from their dogma as blasphemous, how do we fight it?
دوست عزیز ترازو آوریم غم ها بسنجیم
ترازو آوریم غم ها بسنجیم My dear friend, let's bring a scale and measure our pain.
و ما شوخی بود ببخشید جدی
This was a joke. Now let's get to the serious part of the question.
طبیعی است که وقتی حکومتی میخواهد زور بگوید این شهامت رو نداره که صراحتاً بگه من دارم زور میگم.
It's quite natural that when a government wants to impose itself, it is not brave enough to come out and say that I'm imposing myself on you by force.
معمولاً دنبال یک بهانه میگرده که زورگویی خودش رو توجیه کنه.
It usually seeks an excuse to justify the imposition of its will over the people by force.
گاهی اوقات پشت سپر مذهب قایم میشه.
Sometimes under the guise of religion.
و گاهی اوقات به بهانه برقراری امنیت به حقوق مردم تجاوز میکنه.
And at times it violates the rights of its people under the guise of seeking to uphold its interests, the interests of the country.
و گاهی اوقات پشت سپر فرهنگ ملی و حفظ سنن و شعائر باستانی خودش قرار میگیره.
And at times under the guise of upholding national culture and national traditions, etc.
تمام اینها بهانه هایی است که حقوق بشر را زیر پا بگذارند.
These are all excuses to violate human rights.
با مبارزه مسالمت آمیز خصوصا با پناه بردن به سازمان ملل متحد تا حدودی می شود جلوی این طور تازی ها رو گرفت.
Fighting through peaceful means and specifically seeking to resorting to the United Nations is one way of at least mitigating the impact of these policies and preventing them.
مبارزه کوشش برای دموکراسی تمامی ندارد. دائما در تمام عمر بایستی براش کوشش کرد.
Fighting for democracy is endless. One must fight for it throughout life.
And this, I'm afraid, will be our last question.
من منیجر قوامی زرقامی هستم. اولا به وجود شما افتخار میکنم. یکی از کارهایی که شما انجام میدید دفاع از حقوق بچه ها و زنهای ایران هست. و آماری که نشون میده مقدار تعداد زنهایی که فحشا در ایران، خانه های افاف و زنهایی که اینها مورد خشونت های خانوادگی قرار میگیرن. آیا چه کارهایی برای اینها انجام داده میشه و آیا ما از این طرف دنیا چه کمکی میتونیم که انجام بدیم که به هر حال در این راه پیشرفت بکنیم و اینها رو یه ذره به حقوقشون برسیم؟
My name is Manijé Ghavami. I'd like to commend you for your efforts. You've worked a lot on the rights of the child and women in Iran. According to statistics, one of the major problems in Iran is prostitution. There are numerous prostitution homes, and there's violence against women. What measures are being taken to counteract these problems, these social dilemmas and problems, and what can we as Iranians from this other side of the world do to assist in the progress and promotion of the rights of these embattled women?
متاسفانه وضع همینطور است که شما میگید.
Regretfully, the situation in Iran is exactly as you portrayed it.
فحشا در هر جامعه زیربنای اقتصادی داره.
In every society, prostitution has an economic underpinning.
بنابراین ایجاد اشتغال برای زنان راه بسیار مناسبی است که جلوی این کار گرفته بشه.
Therefore, generating employment opportunities for women is a very good way to pursue in order to prevent these problems from increasing.
اگر کسانی امکان سرمایه گذاری در ایران دارند، احداث کارخانجات، کارگاه ها یا وام هایی به زنان که اونها رو بتونه به اشتغال و بی‌نیازی اقتصادی برسونه راه حل بسیار مفیدی است.
For those who have the ability, trying to set up plants, factories, or even workshops or land to women in order to generate income for them are positive measures that could be taken.
و اما کاری که دولت در زمینه اشاعه جلوگیری از فحشا میکنه مثبت به نظر من نیست.
I don't think that the measures taken by the government in preventing the prostitution in Iran are useful.
مجازات زنانی که در خیابان به تن فروشی مجبور میشن راه حل درستی نیست.
Punishing women who are forced to sell themselves on the street is not a desirable way of preventing this problem.
البته در تهران و چند شهر دیگر خانه هایی تأسیس شده برای نگهداری دختران، یعنی بچه های دختر بچه های فراری.
I have to mention that in Tehran and a few other cities, there are shelters and homes that have been set up to protect girls who have left there and escaped from their homes.
اما هم تعداد اینها کمه و همین که اینها فقط به اونهایی که خیلی جوان هستن میرسن.
But they're very few, and they only tend to the needs of the very young ones. And they're not administered and run very well either.
باید کاری کرد که ریشه فحشا یعنی فقر اقتصادی از بین بره.
One must address and uproot the cause of prostitution, which is economic impoverishment.
و متاسفانه در ایران بیکاری زیاده.
And unfortunately, unemployment is very high in Iran.
All right. Well, it is our tradition to give our speaker the last word.
خیلی ممنونم با حوصله تمام حرفهای من رو شنیدید.
Thank you very much for listening to me patiently.
اجازه بدید که بیش از این وقت شما رو نگیرم.
Allow me not to take your time any further.
من آرزوی سلامتی و خوشی و زندگی سرشار از صلح برای شما دارم.
I wish you health, happiness and a life filled with peace.
و ضمناً سخنی نیز با هموطنان خودم.
And I also have a word to share with my fellow Iranians.
جهان تبدیل به دهکده‌ای شده.
The world has transformed into a village.
مرزها از بین داره میره.
Boundaries are disappearing.
آنچه که باقی میماند فرهنگ هاست.
What remains are cultures.
در دهکده جهانی فرهنگ هر قومی باید باقی بماند.
In a global village, the culture of every constituent part of it must remain intact.
و جهان بدین صورت زیباتره.
It is as such that the world becomes more beautiful.
بنابراین در این دهکده جهانی یادتون باشه ایرانی هستی.
In this global village, do remember that you are Iranians. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming, and my special thanks to the Cocolis Fund and the ILAX Foundation, and a special thanks also to our translator, Banal Sheikh Anous. Thank you all for coming.